Hello, everyone. Good evening. This topic, in one word, love, is a very important thing to understand in order to enhance wherever you are in relationships. It's good for people who are getting ready to get married, people in the marriage, people after, maybe, chas v'shalom, after divorce or before the next one. You have to understand the concept of love. Now, love is, we actually have two mitzvot in the Torah speaking about love. One is the famous one of Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha, but the other one is the thing that we say every day, twice a day at least, in Shema, Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha. So there are two mitzvot in the Torah that relate to love, one to Hashem, one to our fellow Jews. Now the question that we have to ask in, or verify, is the following. What is love? And whatever you will answer, you should ask yourself the following question: how we could be commanded to love? Many people assume that love is a sort of feelings. I feel empathy, or I feel close to something, to someone. So if it's a feeling, it's not a thing that you could be commanded to do. I mean, let's take the mitzvah of Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha. Love your fellow Jew the way you love yourself, right? If this person is my friend, by the way, what is the translation of Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha to English? Do you know? Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha. What's the translation? So the translation, even the translation that seems reliable, is wrong. Even in our, not Chas v'Shalom, Christian translation, or not accurate translation, I saw that they translated to Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha, love your neighbor the way you love yourself. Sorry, it's wrong, because those of you who know Hebrew, re'acha is not your neighbor. Neighbor is shchencha. It's not written Ve'ahavta l'shchencha kamocha. Ve'ahavta l're'acha. Re'acha is your friend. And again, we have to ask the question, if this is my friend, I already have feelings toward them, because if not, they're not going to be my friends. So what is the commandment over here? Love your friend. I don't need a commandment for that. And if there is some, let's say, Jew that I don't have any feelings to, not positive, not negative, how I could be commanded to love somebody that I don't have feelings to? I mean, if it's a matter of feelings, either I have the feelings or not. And if I do have them, I do not need commandment. And if I do not have those feelings, you could command me from now to tomorrow. I could not make the feelings be there. So therefore, obviously, we have to understand what is the meaning of the mitzvah, of Ve'ahavta l'ra'acha kamocha. This mitzvah, by the way, is general. It's not just in between a couple, between husband and wife. It's a general mitzvah. So all of this shows us that we need to really try to understand deeply and even practically what love is. So I will start. I don't know how much time we will have here to cover all the points, but I'll try to make the major point. And those are the following. In order to understand love, we have to understand a human being. Love is one of the major needs of every human being in order to develop normally. Every child, every adult, everyone needs love in two terms. She needs to be loved, and he or she need to be able to love others. So in order to understand this basic need, we have to go to the beginning, the creation, when Hashem created Adam HaRishon, Over there, there are very major points that could lead us to understand deeply the concept of love. I will quote the verses, the psukim, because we do not have your ability to show it on the screen, but most of the things are, I hope, you're very familiar with, so I just will quote the description, how Hashem created Adam HaRishon in the beginning, as it's described in Sefer Bereshit. So in Sefer Bereshit, the first chapter, at the sixth day of the creation, it says the following, Vayomer Elokim, Na'aseh Adam betzalmeinu kidmuteinu, ve'yirdu bidgat hayam uvof ha'shamayim uvabehemah uvchol ha'aretz uvchol ha'remes ha'romes al ha'aretz. Hashem wants to create not just another creature, because, you know, the creation was in the 6 days. At the sixth day, Hashem says, now I want to create something special. And the key word over here, ויאמר אלוקים נעשה אדם בצלמנו כדמותנו וירדו בדגת הים. ירדו, they will rule over the creation. Meaning, Hashem says, I'm not going to create another creature. I want to create, in a way, a partner to me. I created the universe. I want to create now a manager who will run it. This is the meaning of the word ויירדו. Yirdu leshon radiyah, ruling. Okay? So in order to create this creature in a way that he will have the ability to rule, Hashem created in very different and special, exclusive way. And that's what the pasuk says. Vayivra Elokim et ha'adam betzalmo, betzalem Elokim bara oto. The translation over here for sure is not good. Tzelem Elokim, what's Tzelem Elokim? So the simple translation is the image of God, but what is the meaning of this? In Hebrew, there are meanings to the word Tzelem Elokim. Anyway, the Adam is the only person, only creature that was created in the Tzelem Elokim. We could call it for now the image of God. The meaning of this, that he is the only creature. You know what, I have to just explain a little bit what Tzelem is. Tzel is a shade or a shadow. You know, when you have, let's take a mirror. When we have a mirror, we have the person, we have the reflection of the person in the mirror. So the reflection of the person in the mirror is the shade, is the shade. In Hebrew, if you know, to take a picture is, how do you say it in Hebrew? Letzalem. It's come from the word tzel, shade. Letzalem. So letzalem is to make something very, very similar to the original. So the tzelem Elokim for now, it's much more deeper than this. There is something in us as human beings that has similarity to God. Of course, we are not God, but we have some similarity. The bottom line of this similarity between human being and Elohim and Hashem is the ability to be a free willer. From all the creatures that Hashem created in the universe, we are the only one who has free will. In certain areas, of course. We do not have free will to live for 500 years or not to eat and exist. Of course, we have some limitations, but we have free wills in certain area, and this is something very unique, very exclusive, only for the human being. All other creatures, everything that you could think of, are not a free willers. They are obligated to the laws of nature, and everything that they will do, it's not them decide to do, but the laws of nature force them to behave so. We, of course, in our body, we have to eat in order to exist, but we have areas that we are really free willer, meaning we could choose to do this way or just the opposite of it in the same option. And the only one who will decide what to do is our will. No one forced us or direct us what to do. And this is very unique, very exclusive. And only in this thing we are in the image or similar to God. He, of course, a free willer, no, nothing force him or direct him to do things. And he gave us this gift or this ability in order to fulfill the job that he has for us to rule the universe that he created. This is the meaning of V'yirdu Bidgataya. Now, let's continue. After Hashem decided to create such a creature, it says in the Pasuk, I'm quoting the Pasuk, Va'ivra Elokim et Adam betzalmo, betzalem Elokim bara oto, zachar unekeva bara otan. And here I'm quoting from the first chapter, Perek Aleph, B'Sefer Bereshit, in the sixth day of the creation, and it's mentioned laconically, you know, just in words, zachar unekeva, male and female created them. When you go to the second chapter, Perek Bet, you will see that it was not at once. It was a process. In the beginning, he created Adam, and then he created Chava, as everyone assume knows, right? But I want to go with you through this because it's very important, as you're going to see. Okay, let's go now to the second chapter, Perek Bet, and we'll see the description in the Torah, how Hashem created Adam. So it says the following, Vayitzer, in Perek Bet Pasuk Zayin, the seventh verse of the second chapter. Vayitzer Hashem Elokim et Adam afar min ha'adamah, vayipach be'apam nishmat chayim, vayhi ha'adam lenefesh chayim. So how was the creation? Hashem created Adam. Now we're talking about Adam without Chava yet. Adam, dust from earth, and he added to this a soul, right? So, Adam is a combination, and that also exclusive to only human being. Adam is a combination of physical, dust from earth, and spiritual. You have to know that Hashem created billions of creatures, and not just the one that science could tell you about, meaning the physical and the physical dimension. There are spiritual creatures also. There are angels, there are spiritual forces. The common denominator of all of them, that they are either made of material or spiritual. There are spiritual entities and physical entities. The only one that has the combination of both is a human being. And this is the meaning of dust from earth, which is the physical, and neshama, soul, which is spiritual. Now, when Hashem took those two elements and combined them together and created Adam, in a way, he created for us a big problem or a big challenge, if you want. Why? Because those two elements, physical and spiritual, are so oppose each other. So not the natural combination, you cannot make a coalition with those two. They are so, just two elements from the opposite sides of reality. Physical is limited by time and space, as you know. Spiritual is not limited by time and space. And the essence of each one of them is so opposed to the other. Because the physical is created or is limited by time and space, what actually interests the physical is the here and the now. Let me explain. Here is space. Here. No physical elements could be in two points, in two places at the same time. So the time, the space limited you to be here. You also could not be in no space. You need space to be, but you cannot be in two points in the space. You have to be here. So here is the limitation, but that the function of space. Time is the now. Now, in the timeline, we have three imaginary points, past, present, and future. Everything that exists now, not in the past, not in the future, right now. So the now and the here are the limits of physical. And because our body is physical, Everything that interested the body is the now and the here. To be able to think about the future is not an ability of the physical. The physical do not look so far. He interested in now and here. Now, the spiritual dimension, what we know about it, is that it's not limited, not by time and not by space. Therefore, the essence of it and the tendency of it is completely different. And when Hashem created, took those two elements, tied them together, throw them to this world, and said, you know what? Get along. He did amazing thing. He created a great job for psychologists and psychiatrists. Because we are always in this conflict because we want things for the physical. The spiritual, not every time that we made a physical decision, happy. The spiritual has something to say and we have to decide what are we doing. Let me give you an example. I'm hungry. I'm very hungry. The only food around is something that not belongs to me, and in order to have it, I have to steal. Okay? Let's take this kind of dilemma. So I'm not talking about somebody who's gonna die. Somebody who's gonna have a hard time to be hungry until he'll get home and then he'll have his own food. So there is a fight, a conflict, inside conflict. The body said, I'm hungry now. The soul will say, wait a second, but it's not yours. You want to be a stealer? So it will be a conflict. Another example, let's take something Jewish. From the same area, I'm hungry, there is a food, it's not kosher. Or it's kosher, but you know, in Israel I always give this example. Kasher be'ashgachat ha-rabanut um-el-fachim. It's kosher in the rabbanut of any Arab village somewhere in Israel. Okay, so what's the conflict? The body wants to eat. And it's not kosher completely. It's not chazir, right? But there is a problem with the kashrut. What are you going to do? So there is an inner conflict between the body and the soul. I want to say something. It will make me so popular. It's such a new, a scoop in news. But it's Lashon Hara. So I want to do it. But somebody said, but listen, it's not right. Who's talking? The soul. And everything that you do is always, you have to make those two sides happy. This is the art of being a human being. It's an art. You have to know that you have two parts, two dimensions. You have to know that you have to make both of them happy, and it's not easy. And this is the challenge. This is the challenge of being a free willer and choose right in all the challenges that we have in life. Okay, so let's go back. Don't forget, our topic is love, right? So still, we still try to put things together in order to draw a big picture out of it. So we are in the second chapter in Bereshit, and Hashem created Adam, a combination of a body and a soul. Fine. Few psukim later, it says something very interesting and need explanations. I'll quote, "Vayomer Hashem Elokim, lo tov hayot Adam levato. E'ese lo ezer kenegdo." Hashem looks at the human being as after he created it, and he said, not good. Not good. He's alone, it's not good. So what, and there is no explanation why it's not good, and there is a problem. If it's not good, why did he do it? Why Hashem created him in the first place this way if it's not good? And you have to know again, another thing that you have to take into account. Adam was created in the sixth day of the creation. Before Adam, Hashem created the animals, the fish, the birds, even the trees. And each one of them is a male and a female. When he created Adam, he created him in purpose, not a male and a female, because there are precedents to this. And then he looked at him and he said, not good. Not good. It's not good that he will be alone. So, no explanation why it's not good. When it's a problem, why he created him to, he doesn't know in advance that it's not good. But what's the solution? Eselo ezer kenegdo. What is the translation of the words? Eselo ezer kenegdo. Eselo ezer kenegdo, I will, it's not good that he will be alone. I will make to him somebody to help him. But if you know Hebrew again, you'll feel the problem, which is in the depth of the words. Ezer in Hebrew, ezer is to help, lazor. Kenegdo in Hebrew could be two meanings. Kenegdo is alongside to him, or kenegdo against him. Kenegdo, neged, against. So these two words, actually, in them there is a contradiction. Ezer is a positive connotation. Kenegdo is a negative connotation. So what's going on over here? Okay, we'll get back to this, but I'm just putting the question, all the things that we have to verify. So after Hashem said that, or decided that it's not good, he wants to create him a helper against him or alongside of him. Also, something very unusual. It's written that later, in the next few verses, ויפל השם אלוקים תרדמה על האדם ואישן ויקח אחת מצלותיו ויסגור בשר תחתינו. He put him into anesthesia. Adam Rishon was the first man in the world that was under anesthesia. Hashem put him under anesthesia, okay? Put him to sleep. And it was an operation, and in the operation Hashem took one of his ribs or sides and creates out of it his wife, Chava. And again, it's very unusual. As we said before, Hashem created, before Adam, all the animals, all of them were male and female. But when he created the male and the female, he didn't create them one from the other. He created a he-dog, he created a she-dog. He created a he-horse, he created a she-horse. Not from it. So here we have very many questions that we have to understand. Why Adam was created in the first place by himself? And then Hashem said it's not good. And then it has, okay, we have to create him a female. Fine. But why from him? Why he put him into anesthesia and took the bone or the side and made out of it the lady, the Chava? Okay, but it says the following, ואיבן השם אלוקים את הצלה אשר לקח מן האדם לאישה, the Torah emphasizes that it was taken from Adam לאישה, והביאה אל האדם. And Adam saw his wife first time and he said, wow, לזאת יקרה אישה, כי מאיש לוקחה זאת. He himself realized that the proper name in Hebrew to give to this creature is אישה. Why? Because it was she was taken from the ish. Ki me'ish lukha zot. Okay, now let's try to, after all this, to get to our topic. As I said before, when Hashem created human being, Adam, from a body and a soul, this by itself is a big, big project for every human being, to realize that he, she has a body and has a soul, that they are completely different from each other in their essence, in their tendency, in their interests. And the art is to relate to both of them, and the art of life is to make harmony between the body and the soul. That by itself is a big, big challenge. After Hashem did this, Hashem said, no, that's not good. It's not good enough. The challenge is not good enough. Let me make it more complicated, Hashem says. So he took the body of Adam and created another body from the body, but not the same body. This is a male, this is a female. And you have to know that male and female, the Gemara says, are two completely different nations, different entities. The Gemara says, Nashim am bifnei atzmo. It's a nation by itself. We know it. I mean, we know that there are characters of male character or female character. Of course, basically they are the same, but there are more things that more relate to men or other attributes that relate to women. And it's not, I mean, even if it's physical, but it's not enough. The Torah didn't say where the neshama of Chava was taken from, right? Okay, the body came from the body of Adam. Where the neshama came from? The Kabbalah sources says that Hashem created one neshama. Vayitzar Hashem Elokim et Adam afar min Adama vayipach ba'apam nishmat chayim. This is the only neshama, the only soul that Hashem created. When Hashem created Chava, He took this same neshama and divided it to two. The male part stayed by Adam, the female part came to Hashem put in Chava. So what we have over here right now, we have body and soul of Adam, body and soul of Chava. When Hashem says, when it was before, before He created Chava, the body and the soul of Adam, Hashem said, it's not good, it's not good. And it doesn't say what's not good. It's not good. But in order this not good to be good, what will be the solution? That I'll make another creature from this one, Ezer Kenegdo. And as we said, Ezer is to help, Kenegdo is against. Okay, now, after all this philosophy, let's go a little bit to practical. Let's learn first what Ezer Kenegdo is. Ezer Kenegdo. In order to develop as a human being, we have to realize that we have body and soul, and we have attributes, and some of them are very good. Each one is different. I mean, everyone has their own quality in their personality. But nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. Therefore, our mission in this world is to take the not good attributes that we have and work on them. Usually, people are lazy enough to push it. I know that I'm not perfect. It's very easy for me to relate to myself and to present myself in society with my qualities. I know that they have some shortcomings, but everybody has, as I said to myself. And let's, you know what, one day maybe I'll work on them. The Gemara says that, I'll quote you from the Gemara. The Gemara says that someone who is not married, don't feel offended if you're not, Bezrat Hashem soon. Someone who is not married, he is not complete. He could not be complete until he will be married, he or she. Why? Because marriage forces you to complete your shortcoming. You could push them, hide them, you could hide them from everywhere, everyone, even from yourself. You could not hide them, your shortcoming, from your spouse. Your spouse is there, and it's there for help you to complete, to fix your shortcomings. This is the only way to grow, to face reality. And you could, you know, ignore it, deny it, when you have a spouse that lives with you day up, day in, day out, you have someone that knows you even better than you think, because you're not seeing yourself in the real way. Of course, people could use it not in the right way. But real love is when I see my spouse. Of course, I'm with this person that I choose to marry because I realize his qualities. But I'm here to help him, to help her, to grow and fix the shortcomings. And vice versa, she's to me, I'm to her. This should be the real way of looking at marriage. Unfortunately, people are not doing this. People, of course, they are there with spouse because of the qualities, especially before they got married. After they got married, they knew in advance that, in most of the cases, that this person is not perfect, unless they were really naive. And in the marriage, they could think, you know what? Yes, there are those qualities. Because of those qualities, I'm with you. But you know what? Now when I live with you, your shortcomings are really annoying and really bothering. And here start the problems, here. And this is the difference between real love, which we'll define later, to artificial love that is so popular, and therefore, because of this wrong attitude, we could find that so many people who got married are so disappointed from this marriage, and in many cases they just break it after a few months, few years, or even longer. But they could not manage together. Now let's learn again deeply few things that it's written in our sources in order to understand this. Hashem gave us challenges. We are here for facing and grow from challenges. The first challenge is the fact that we have body and soul. This is a big challenge. Because if you want to be happy, you could not just deny or ignore one of those major things. So many people know a lot about their body. They do not know that they have a soul. The vast majority of the world do not know that they have a soul. And even those who heard that there is such a thing have no clue what is this and how to relate to it. And therefore, many people live their life over here when they actually actualize less than 50%, because they do not know about their spiritual dimension. So the first challenge for everyone before marriage, before you get married, is to realize that you have a body, you have the soul. What do you do? What do you know about your soul? How do you run the body and the soul together in the right way? But even if you did this, you are not complete until you'll get married. When you get married, and this is the challenge, and this is what Hashem says, it's not good, and in order for it to be good, I have to do it this way. So he took the first thing, divided it into two, body and soul. He took those two, body and soul, and divide them to two also, which is four elements. We have his body, his neshama, her neshama. The goal is to unify the entire thing. His body with her body, his neshama with his neshama, with her neshama. This is the goal. Now, in order to understand that it's impossible unless you know the secret, let me quote a very, very famous quote from Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva says the following. It's mentioned in the Talmud in a few places. One of the sources is Masechet Sotah Daf Yud Zayin Amud Aleph. Says Rabbi Akiva the following: Ish v'isha zachu shchina b'neim, lo zachu esh ochaltam. I'll translate it. Ish v'isha. Husband and wife, man and a lady, zachu, the translation over here is always problematic because it doesn't, even if I try to translate it in the best way, it will not be what it means in Hebrew. Zachu, in a way, to translate it is to, if they're lucky, if they're lucky, zachu, shechina b'nehem. But it doesn't make any sense. What does it mean? If they lucky, they got shechina b'nehem. Shechina is the divine dwell. Hashem dwell between them. Zachu, if they lucky. So it's not the right translation. I'll explain it in Hebrew. What is the meaning of this? Ish v'isha, zachu, shechina b'nehem. Lo zachu. You know what? Let's continue with the lucky and not lucky. If they're not lucky, Esh ochaltam. Esh ochaltam, fire gonna eat them up. Fire. Now what's the meaning of this? In Hebrew, how do you write the word ish? Three letters, right? Aleph, Yud, Shin. How do you write the word isha? Aleph, Shin, Hey. The common denominator between those two names are the letters Aleph and Shin. Aleph and Shin are in the name of Ish and of Isha, right? What's the difference? The Yud and the Hey. Yud and the Hey are the letters that describe the name of Hashem. One of the names of Hashem is Yud Hey. Now, Rabbi Akiva says the following, and it's very deep what he said. Let's explain this. Without the Yud and the Hey, if you take the Yud and the Hey, which is the name of Hashem, take it out of the concept of Ish v'Isha, you're going to be left with Esh and Esh. Esh is fire. Esh is fire. So you have fire here, fire here. And what is the definition of fire? Let's define it. What's fire? Fire is something that exists when it's consuming and burning stuff. If you stop feeding the fire will die. So the fire, by its essence, is consuming. When Rabbi Akiva says that Ish and Isha without the Yud in the Hay, we find over here two fires that will exist when they fire each other. The only solution is not to call the fire department, but to put the name of Hashem in their names. Meaning, when we got married, it's not just me and you. Hashem should be here too. If not, there is no chance. No chance. It will be fire with fire. What is the meaning of this? And let's go back to the word zachu, in the right understanding of it. It's not if they're lucky. Zchut, in Hebrew, has two meanings. Merit, zchut, and purification. Lezakech mashu, to lezakech is to purify. When I have a dirty water, I purify the water. I take the thing that doesn't belong and take them out and stay with the pure water. It's called purification, which is zchut. The meaning over here of the word zachu, what Rabbi Akiva says, ish v'isha zachu shechina b'nehem, lo zachu esh ochaltam, the meaning is both merit, but mainly purified, if they purify themselves. Now we have to understand, what is ish and what isha? Ish v'isha he has body and a soul, she has body and a soul. The soul, we have to know, we sang it every morning. Elokai neshama shenatata bi tehorai. My soul that Hashem gave me is purified, is clear, is clean, is pure. So the neshama is pure. My neshama is pure, your neshama is pure. So what's the problem? What's not pure? The body. Between those two, body and the soul is pure, the body is not. So what do you have to do? You have to clean up, to purify the body. How do you purify the body? What's the problem with the body that you have to purify it? The problem is that the body has needs, but the body has to be controlled. It's connected to a long story that I could not go now into it. But we have to know the body of the human being, especially if the human being, this is interesting and funny, and only human being, the ironic thing, we are the most intelligent creatures, compared to animals at least, right? And we are the most stupid creatures in the way we're running our life. I'm talking about physical. Let me give you one example. That will be an example. Again, food. We need to eat in order to exist, right? Animals also need to eat in order to exist. Animals, without knowing anything about health, instinctively eat what they need, how much they need. And usually they are not visiting the doctor every Monday and Tuesday. They know instinctively, they are not eating more than they need to eat. We are intelligent creatures. We know a lot about the dangers of not good food, and yet, most of us, I mean, in the human race, not eating properly. We should eat something that's healthy, in the right amounts to give us all the nutrition that we need, that were what we should. But many people prefer the yummy, tasty over the healthy. And this is funny. I mean, why? Why? And it's not, there's nothing wrong with yummy or tasty, but sometimes it leads us, when we just become addicted to it, to eat things that could ruin our health and kill us. And we do eat this. You know how many people died from not eating properly during their life? Very big percentage. And this is one example. So we have body, we have to know about, we have to know the secret on our body. Our body do not know what he really needs. We need to control it. We need to control it. It's not just food. We have more things that relate to the fact that we have, that our body is a material thing. In the higher level, a little bit, is the ego. The ego, the egoism, is something that relates to the fact that we have a body, not that we have a soul. And because of the egoism, we have many very, very destructive attributes. As the Mishnah says, there are three major, it's like a dragon that has three heads. And many people who do not cut the heads of those dragons, they're going to ruin themselves. The Mishnah in Masechet Avot says the following: Hakina'a vehata'ava vehakavod motzi'im et ha'adam min ha'olam. Kina is jealousy. Ta'ava is extra desire. Kavod, pursuing that everyone will honor me and respect me, extra, in exaggerated way. So we have to know that Maharal says, and deeply in the Medrash and the Kabbalah, it says that those three heads are the three heads of the same dragon. And the dragon, in one word, could be ego. Ego. I'm in the center. And actually, the first sin ever was the Chet Adam Arishon. The first sin, who made him or who tempted him and his wife to go against what's right, against what Hashem directed them? The serpent, right? The Nahash. So the Nahash is this dragon. And this dragon has three heads. Let me explain, in order to understand what purification the body needs. What was the sin of Adam HaRishon? Hashem put him in the Garden of Eden, and in the Garden of Eden were many, many trees. Two trees in the Garden of Eden were Etz HaChaim, the tree of life, and Etz HaDa'at Tov V'Ra. The tree that if you eat from its fruits, you could be distinguish between relative and good and evil. Okay? So Hashem told Adam HaRishon, listen, I made you with body. This body need to eat. You see all the fruits over here of all the trees and gardens? It's all yours. Go ahead. You could eat from them. There's one tree over here that I'm warning you, don't eat from its fruit. If you'll eat from this tree fruits, you're going to die. So that was the commandment, right? Came the Nahash, the serpent, the Nahash HaKadmoni. And what actually he tried to say? He tried to convince Adam that he needs something that he really do not need. Because you need to eat, look, all the variety. But he told him, no, you need this one, which actually you do not need. Hashem says, no. But the Nahash says, you need what you do not need. Okay? And this is the principle. And he caused Adam, of course, the responsibility on Adam, but he caused Adam to not listen to God with all the consequences, death and etc., work hard. You have to know that this is the major problem that we have since then until today. That was the Mishnah says in Masechet Avot. Hakin'ah ve'ata'avah ve'akavod motzi'im et ha'adam, not just Adam HaRishon, את אדם הראשון הם הוציאו מגן עדן. They took him out of the Garden of Eden. But all the descendants of Adam, בני אדם, could be ruined their world, מוציאים את האדם מן העולם, if they continue to do the same. And look what actually he's doing until today. In very sophisticated way. And with a great success from his point of view. You all know what advertising is. Advertising, right? In the media, in the newspaper. What advertising? Let me give you a very popular example. Cell phones, right? Every few months, every year, few months, there is a new cell phone. What do you have? iPhone, this number? Okay, the next number is coming. So they made a lot of advertisements, you know, and then you feel when it comes out, if you stay with the old one, come on. Everyone has the new one. You must have it, right? So, if you look at it, I have nothing about cell phones, and I love my cell phone, and I think it's very practical. I'm just giving it as an example. Advertising is doing the same thing. They convinced you, convincing you that you need something that you really do not need. You could manage with what you have already, but they give you the feelings that you could not be not updated. Because of this, what's wrong with that? Because of this, people focus their life to get the new thing. So they leave everything else aside. It's not important. The main thing is to get the new car, to get the new location and the new house and the new this tablet and this computer and this. This is the focus. That's what you do. And it costs you time, which is very, very expensive. Time is very expensive. Time is life. You know, in English, they say here in America, time is money. In Jewish, we know the right thing. Time is not money. Time is life. Time is life. So use it in the right way. What this advertisement cause you to do? To invest on your life, which is the most expensive thing that you have, in nonsense. In things that really do not the main thing that you should do in your life. And let's go to kinat ahava v'kavod, which is implication of the ego, which is a part, or the essence of it, is the physical element, which is the body. Let me give you a definition, amazing definition of jealousy. Jealousy is one of the three heads of this dragon, right? What is a jealousy? Jealousy is the following. I'm looking around and I'm saying, in my subconscious, of course, I have everything that I need. I have enough. But how come you have more than me? The meaning of this is, I had enough, I have everything that I need. But the fact that you are here and you have more than me, get me the feelings that I do not have what I need because you have more than me, which is not true. If you were not here, I would be the most happiest person ever. Because you are here, I feel that I'm missing something. You see the pattern? You want something that you do not really want, that you do not really need. And this is a problem. This is the same idea of the Chet Adam HaRishon. You need what you do not need. Now, this is so true. Jealousy is a fake thing. Again, let me put it again this way. If you were not here, I would be the happiest person. I have everything that I need. The fact that you are here caused me to think that I'm missing something. Obviously, it's not true. You're not missing anything. But the jealous person do not know it. He really believes that you're missing something. And that could ruin the life. This is jealousy, kina. What's ta'ava? Ta'ava is extra desire. I want more than I need. Instead of, let's say, again, I give one example in one area. It's true for all the other areas. I need to eat healthy food and in a very reasonable amount. But my desire is to eat something that's not that healthy, but more tasty. And not in the right amount and not in the right times. And that could cause you ruin your physical life, technically. And it's not just in food, all the other desires. When you have extra desires that above what you really need, you could ruin your life. And the same way about kavod, I'm not going to speak about kavod right now. Anyway, this is the problem with the body. And this is the thing that needs purification. So let's go back to the words of Rabbi Akiva. Ish v'isha, zachu shechina b'nein. Zachu, if they're, not just if they're lucky, they have to do something in order to be lucky. If they will purify their ego, their extra need and extra wants of the body, then the harmony between their body and their soul will be right, and then they could talk about harmony between both of them, him and her. And that could be achieved only by Shechina. By Hashem. Because how do I know what's right and what's wrong? How do I know when I cross the border? The body do not know. And it could convince me, even if I'm a very smart person, that this is the right thing for me to do. So I need an objective ruler to tell me what's right and what's wrong. The objective ruler is the Torah. Torah is, what's the translation of the word Torah? Instructions, directions. Who do you give direction to? A person that do not know by themselves. And we have to know, we do not know by ourselves what's right, what's wrong, without the instructions from God. Therefore, we need Shechina Beneihem. And if you have Shekhinah, if you have Hashem between you and your spouse, one thing for sure, you're never going to argue. You're never going to fight. You're not going to... It's not the ego, my ego versus your ego. I know that I do not know. If you know that you do not know, and we both know that the only way to know is to go to the Torah, and we will do what's right according to the Torah. And I will be willing to, if I realize that I think, or I think wrong, I want something wrong, that the Torah said no, I said, you know what? I'm wrong, I want to do what's right. So it's not an ego versus ego. It's not my ego. It's not you won, I won, scoring. It's we both agree that we are obligated to the laws of Hashem. In this case, you'll have harmony. You'll have, without this, it's a fire against fire. Without it, that was Rabbi Akiva says. Ish v'isha zachu, if they purify themselves through the Torah, connecting to Hashem, shechina b'nehem, they will be a complete happy couple. If not, if they will not zachu, they're not purified themselves, esh ocholtan, it's a fire against fire. And that's, you know, in a few minutes, learn something that will teach us what real love is. Unfortunately, love is an area that you could see the crisis around it all over the world. In marriage, the statistics are very, very... Every third couple within 3 years will be divorced or separated. This is the statistics, and it's going and it's become worse. Which shows that it's not a problem of one couple, that they are not managing. It could happen. If it's this much in the percentage, something wrong in the system. So what's wrong in the system? The educators who teach most of the population of the world, and when I'm saying most, I'm talking about above 95%, what love is, the educator is Hollywood. Hollywood get to every house in New Zealand, in Australia, in Africa, South America, everywhere. Since day one almost, you know, the easy babysitter is the TV. Kids, you know, they're watching only, you know, innocent programs for kids. But what are they teaching them there? And it started from day one to 120 for many people. They're watching TV. What is the story in the TV? In all the programs. It's always connected to he and she. And they teach you about relations. I mean, the stories are imaginary stories, but this is the way our children and ourselves, if we're exposed to this, learn what love is. The cruel thing about it is that in all this TV programs, you have a couple. You have a man, you have a lady. He is strong, businessman, successful, whatever. She's beautiful, they're married, but almost in every program, the story is there is another lady or man involved in their life. Those are the movies, at least for not small children. So what's the damage? A little kid watching a TV show, he has heroes. I want to be like this man, if it's a boy. I want to be like this lady, if it's a girl, right? So we learn from day one what will make us successful. If I'm a lady, I have to be thin, beautiful, whatever. If I'm a man, I have to be. This is the thing that every child, every kid, but learned. And when they will get married, they will look for something that they thought or developed in their mind since very early age. What is the ideal thing? I want to be like this, I want to be like that. And unfortunately, you know how it looks in the movies, and it reflects the reality. The reality is following this. The love of Hollywood is just the opposite of what real love is. What is the definition of love? So we have to know, there is a famous Rav Dessler. Rav Dessler was one of the great scholars who lived about 50 years ago. He wrote a book called Mikhtav Me'eliyahu. In Mikhtav Me'eliyahu, he says the following. People think, mistakenly, that when I love somebody, I give them gifts. I love someone, so I give them to show my appreciation. He says it's wrong, it's just the opposite. The more you give, the more you love. You love the one who you give to. Now to give, it's not a simple thing. Most of the people are takers, are not givers. It's come again from the ego. Because the material is limited by time and space, the essence of it is lack, so the lack caused me to take from outside inside. And that caused the ego taking technically or jealousy or pursuing all these negative attributes. It's come from the fact that we have a body which is material, and material taking from outside in. So most of the people in the world are taker, are not givers. And even those who think or consider themselves givers, if you really check it, you'll find out that it's not true. I will give in order to get. So someone who gives in order to get, is he a giver or a receiver or a taker? He's a taker. Why? Because if I'll give and give and give and give and give, and I realize at some point that I'm not getting anything. People using me. You know, in Hebrew it's called frayer. The one who give and give and give and give, and everybody realize, oh, this is given, they go and take from him, and he never get anything. So many people in this case will say, you know what? No, I don't want people to use me. I have no problem to give, I love to give, but they want to get. If I realize that they stop getting, I'll stop giving. So if I'm giving in order to get, I'm not a giver, I'm a taker. My purpose is to get at the end. I'm willing to give in order to get. This is not giving. Giving is giving without condition, without expecting to get. This is giving. And this is love. And in short, I just explained this the following. There is a story about someone who went to a restaurant. First time in his life in this restaurant, he heard about this restaurant. He came to the restaurant, okay? He heard good things about their food. They give him a menu. He looked at the menu, he could not understand the word. You know, today restaurants, they give, if you're not Japanese or whatever, you could not understand what they're talking about. What is this? So he came to the restaurant, they give him a menu, he looked at it, do not understand a word. Next to him, in the next table, was someone that he never met before, but he was there before. They gave him the menu, they came to ask to get the order, and he told them, give me this and this and this. So when the waiter went to the kitchen to give the order, this new guy asked him, listen, I see you're familiar over here, could you do me a favor? What do you recommend over here? Because I don't understand. So he told him, listen, they have very good food. I chose a fish dish. Okay, so after a while, he asked him, why did you choose this particular dish? He said, this is fish, and I love fish. Then at this point, the entire discussion turned to being philosophical discussion. He told him, what did you say? You love fish? Don't ever say that, it's not true. So then what do you mean? I love fish. He told him again, don't say that, it's not true. Let me tell you why. If you love fish, you really love fish, how come you dig it? You fish it from the water. You love him, right? He wants to be in the water. If you want his interest and you love the fish, let the fish stay where the fish wants to be, in the water. Why you fish it? You know, what happened when you fish the fish? He started choked, right? He could not breathe. So let me show you what you do in the name of love to this fish. You took him out of the water. You caused him to be uncomfortable. And you could not see him like this, right? So what do? Because you have a lot of mercy on him. You take a big thing, hit his head in order to make him stop feeling uncomfortable. When he is dead, because you love him, you take him to the kitchen. You put a frying pan and you put oil and make sure that the oil is really, really hot. Then, because of your love, you take this fish, cut him, take him out of these bones, put him in the fry pan, made it well done, because you really love it. Eat it to the last piece. Make it just disappear. And you still saying that you love fish? You do not love fish. You love yourself eating fish. So don't say you love fish. Okay, this is the story. Now let's go out and see people in love. And imagine a couple that's going out for a few weeks, a few months. Something starts to develop. Usually she will wait that he will say something. But he has time. He didn't say anything. She, in most of the cases, she will say it before. I love you. Okay? Finally, maybe he also will say it. Now let me ask you honestly, what actually they really mean when they say, I love you? Unfortunately, in the world around us, they mean, I love you as a fish. Meaning, I love me. I love me getting from you whatever I think you could give me. This is a selfish love. And this is the love of Hollywood. And this is just the opposite of what love is. Love is giving, not taking. The selfish love is the cause of everything. And the tragic thing that they took two words in Hebrew that very similar in the sound, but they're so just the opposite. One word is ahava, love, ahava. The other one is ta'ava, desire. The meaning of them is just the opposite. Ta'ava is taking what I'm getting from it. Ahava is giving. We do not have time now to go through all of this. One thing, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have two mitzvot in the Torah. Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha, ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. What is ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha? Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha is not hugging, because Hashem has no body. He doesn't have anybody, it's not physical. What is the meaning of me loving Hashem, loving God? And in the same word, Hashem says in Torah, ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Reacha is your fellow Jew. Your fellow Jew has a body. But when Hashem says, ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha, when Hashem doesn't have a body, and ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha, when your fellow friend has a body, it means the same way. Love is not in the body. Love is in the soul. Only the soul could give. The body do not know how to give. The body know how only how to get. So real love is a connection, a spiritual connection, between, and this is giving with no condition, from me to her, from her to me. If you have this, and that could be only if you really purified, meaning you take all your shortcomings of the body, of the physical, and put them under control, you do it, she will do it, then the love could be based on the connection between the spiritual dimension of you and her. And then the fact that you have bodies, and the body also has interest, that's fine, but what is the base? If the base is the body, it's a recipe for ruin. If the base, if this is the soul, this is the only recipe of real love. There is much more, but that's what we could cover now. And I could assume that it's not the usual way of popular lecture about love that you used to hear, but I came here to say something special, okay? So I hope everyone could get some benefit from it and enhance our life in general and our love specifically. Thank you so much.